in the memory of those who died to the floor over the years. Martin will start off our talk for this afternoon. Martin, over to you.
Sure.
Thank you.
Very good. So I'll start on a PowerPoint fanatic. So the first slide, Irish in the First World War. If we look at the best starting point is the Commonwealth War Graves Commission data. It gives next of kin in about 50% of the cases, and in World War I there's about 22,000 Irish addresses on their records. If we categorise them by origin, the focus of the Irish involvement in the First World War are the 9 infantry regiments of the British Army, which contains over 55% of that number. Just a perspective, Irish in the British Army, that's about 20% of the total. That's the next biggest category. That would include non-regional regiments such as artillery. Over 1,000 Irish gunners died in the war, and Royal Engineers, and then specifically non-Irish units. We'll look into that later. Royal Navy, about 1,500. Again, we'll get into a bit more detail later. In terms of dominions, it's all of them. It's just 10%, and about half of those are Canada, where you still get active Irish emigration pre-World War I. It's pretty much tailed off to Australia, New Zealand. There's a New Zealand website which gives just over 1,000 Irish dead. They had 18,000 dead in World War I. And South Africa, negligible, but of interest there is there was actually a South Africa Irish regiment raised at the start of the war. It just served in the German West Coast of the first. So that's disbanded out of the American population. The Americans did a draft census for about half their male population in 1917, and we have an accurate figure for that. There's 156,000 Irish-born males eligible for service, so that's actually only 0.7%. It's half of what we would expect. So maybe the Irish population is aging. There's less recent emigration. And then another reliable figure we have is New York. New York. There's nearly 10,000 Irish-born served from New York in the U.S. Army in World War I. But New York is 10% of the U.S. population, but we can't multiply that by 10 because probably New York had a very much above average Irish presence. So it's difficult to get an idea of how many Irish in the U.S. Army. Probably the 0.7% is the most accurate figure. I mean, 4.7 served with the U.S. forces. Only 2 million got to France. So we're probably looking at about 15,000 actually seeing action, and maybe 30,000 getting conscripted into the U.S. Army. And we just quickly look at the most Irish regiment of the American Army, World War I, the 165th Infantry. It got that number when it was mobilised for federal service. Its lineage was the famous 69th New York Militia, which served in the American Civil War on the Union side. It was part of the 42nd Division, its National Guard Division, which tried to represent as many states of the Union as possible. It ended up with 26 states represented, and it had this New York National Guard Regiment. It went to France quite early. It got there by November 1917. So it actually saw a full year's action, which was quite unusual because most American units came much later. It suffered. Over 644 killed in action. An American regiment, it's the normal pattern, 3 battalions, 1, 2, 3. So each of those battalions would have had over 200 killed in action, which is average for a year's service on the Western Front. And pretty much they took 100% casualties. If you look at wounded, it's at 2,500 wounded. They got 65% of the strength was replaced by replacement drafts, and it had 180 days contact with the enemy. The American equivalent of the Commonwealth War Graves Commission is the American Battlefields Commission. They maintain their war graves. It's less complete than the Commonwealth data because the Americans offer the option of repatriation of war dead home, which is on average taken up by 60% of the war dead, repatriated to the US. So the ABC sort of looks after the remainder, who are consolidated in large cemeteries by British standards. There's 430 dead from this regiment on the American Battlefields Commission website. Two-thirds are from New York, so obviously it's a very local regiment. And again, we can see which months in 1918 they endured heavy combat, it's particularly July and October. And just anecdotal sources say that the regiment's personnel were very heavily of Irish origin, originally 85%, and still by the end of the war maybe 50%. So that's the main Irish-American unit to see action in the First World War. We just quickly give a mention to France. We have to. It's a smaller population than the UK, 40 million. They suffered twice as many dead. We have to remember that. 1.4 million dead. They bore the brunt of the war up to mid-1916. Their war dead are also online. We'll find one Irish-born casualty there, a man from County Clare who enlisted in the Foreign Legion at Dunkirk in September 1914 and killed in action 1917. He has a known grave. As I said, he's from County Clare. The County Clare Library has a great website with World War I research. They have full data on this guy. He was actually a railwayman. He's on the Houston Station World War I Memorial. Picture of the grave, everything. They also found about 43 Clare-born dead in the US Army in World War I. They brought to my attention this New York World War I website. It's really impressive research. Now, we'll go back to the British Army, the Irish and the British Army. This is just a basic summary of all nine infantry regiments dead by year. Probably the thing most worthy of note here is 1915 was actually the worst year for five of those nine regiments. They're all southern regiments. 1915, maybe it's a year we tend to forget apart from Gallipoli, but you don't have a mass British army yet. Those regular units are still holding the line, and it's a very intense combat, 1915, and it's actually the worst year for the Dublin Fusiliers, who both regular battalions had an incredible over 500 dead in one year. In 1915, the first at Gallipoli, the second in May, gas attacks in France. And then, moving on to 1916, which probably would expect would be the worst year. It is for the three northern regiments representing the Ulster Division. The 1st of July was the British Army's worst day of the war, over 20,000 killed in action, and 2,000 of those were in the Ulster Division. And 1917, 1918, for the British Army, it's stable, but the Irish presence is dropping off. You can see at the bottom the Irish presence of the British Army is declining, recruiting has dropped off, and units are getting disbanded. Just quickly for the Royal Navy, about 1,500 Irish dead. As usual, it's dominated by the three big cities, Belfast, Dublin, Cork. Interestingly, Cork comes second. It had all this infrastructure ports around Queenstown Cove and Bear Island, what later became the treaty port. So it's the Cork tradition in the Royal Navy is of interest. And then the next three, as you expect, are coastal counties, Waterford, Wexford, Galway, each about 4%. Irish dead in non-British units. This is interesting as it shows you Irish emigration patterns pre-World War I, which would change later on. The top, I'll just run through, but basically it's dominated by Scotland and Lancashire. So the top two, the two Scottish regiments recruited from Glasgow. Then we have Liverpool, England's most Irish city. The 8th Battalion of the King's Liverpool Regiment was the Liverpool Irish, a territorial unit, about 8% Irish-born, and of course many of Irish origin. And then another two Scottish lowland regiments, South Lancashire's Northumberland Fusiliers. They had an entire brigade of Tyneside Irish. pretty minimal Irish-born elements, but probably heavily recruited from the local Catholic population. Then we have Lancashire Fusiliers, three more Scottish Highland regiments, and English, Manchester, East Lancashire, and only now have we come to London, the City of the Royal Fusiliers, City of London Regiment, way down the list. You also had a London Irish Regiment, which is a territorial regiment of a separate county of London Regiment. It's Irish connections in World War I, but very, very, very minimal, very few. It's quite significant in World War II. It's interesting. It really shows you pre-World War I Irish emigrations to Lancashire, to Scotland, I guess, where the jobs were, height of industrialisation. It's certainly not London-focused, as we might think now. Just quickly run through the worst days of the war. The regiments in total, no surprises. 1st July, the Ulster Division, over 2,000 dead. 16th August 1917, that's when the 16th Irish and 36th Ulster Divisions attacked side by side, 3rd Ypres. It was northern regiments which disproportionately suffered that day. The troops from the 16th Irish Division, okay, Dublin Fusiliers, but also the three northern regiments. Interesting, that turned out to be a bad day for the Northern Regiment as well. 21st of March 1918, this is actually the second worst day of the war for the British Army, 8,000 dead. It's the huge German offensive. You may have seen the film Journey's End from last year. It depicts that offensive. Nearly 1,000 Irish dead, both Irish divisions in the front line, and they actually ended up suffering the highest losses in that German offensive. Then we come to 9th of September 1916, the Battle of Ginchy. Ginchy captured by the 16th Irish Division. 9th of May 1915, Battle of Festubert, a failed British offensive. 7th of June 1917, that's Messines, a highly successful attack, 16th, 36th attacking side by side. It's significant for casualties, though, about 350 fatalities. And finally, 21st of August 1915, that's the final attempt, the last British effort at Gallipoli. It's the regular battalions, Dublin's Inniskilling Fusiliers, suffered very heavily in that, and the Connaught Rangers, who were fighting with the Australians in their sector. This is an Irish World War I enlistment. I mean, just the figures I want to point out there. We can't analyse 32 counties, it's just too detailed, but I've basically grouped them into the official regimental districts, the recruiting districts. And Irish recruitment, it's dominated by Belfast, Dublin and Cork, the three big cities. So at the bottom of blue, that's basically Belfast, counties Antrim and Down. In 1914, nearly half of Irish recruitment comes from there. It's an absolute avalanche of recruits. And then the rest of the war, you can see about 30%. Dublin, it's about a quarter, 26,000 joined up. It was 50,000 in Belfast. And third, the grey is the Royal Munster Fusiliers area. It's hovering around. It gets off to a low start. It's sort of averaging about 18% as the war goes on. That was about 18,000 recruits. The others, it's insignificant by comparison. These are more rural areas, no big cities. So it's really, Irish recruitment is dominated by those three locations. And again, just no surprise, but this is the amount of recruits Irish regiments received during the war. It's down to a monthly basis, but it's often said Irish recruitment ended after the Easter Rising, and to a certain extent it's true. It's maybe not because of it had already peaked, but you see a large number, 1914, again, that's really Belfast, and it holds up during 1915, but then it's really collapsed mid-1916 onwards. And October 1916, there was a manpower survey done in Ireland. It's interesting. It attempts to see how many males of military age are still available in the country for recruitment. And here it's grouped by regimental district again. At the bottom, you have the Royal Irish Rifles. Antrim Down, it considers that 70% of the available manpower has already joined up by then. And and the second Dublin, the Dublin Fusiliers District, over 40%, and then we have the Northern Regiments, Irish Fusiliers and Skinnings, and the Connaught Rangers down only 20%. But one thing that analysis would not take care of, not take account of, is Irish emigration to Britain. County Mayo, 40% of its war dead were actually in non-Irish British units, reflecting a big emigration tradition. And then, this is just an example, the same data done by county. Again, Belfast very high, 80%, northern counties, even Dublin, 40-50%. And these are all over 40% have basically joined up of available manpower. And just the southern counties, the highest one after Dublin, you'd have Tipperary. A lot of small towns there, an interesting county to analyse, Carlow, Leash, Offaly, Kings, Queens counties. And another thing to look at, Irish regiments, First World War, trying to relate the recruiting in their district with how many recruits the regiments got. At the top we have the big three, the Irish Rifles, Belfast, Munsters and Dublins. They only got about 60% of the recruits you would have expected them to receive based on the recruiting patterns in their districts. The reason for this is they basically subsidise the rural regiments, and that's reflected at the bottom of the graph, would show like the Enniskillen Fusiliers, Connaught Rangers, Irish Fusiliers. They're about twice the size you would expect them to be given the level of recruitment in their district. So again, you have this, the big city subsidising the more rural regiments. And getting on to another theme here, the Irish in the First World War, it's basically the townsmen, people from towns and cities over 2,000 in the 1911 census. The urban population of Ireland was a quarter of the population, but that's basically where the war participants came from. And the Irish regiments were all overwhelmingly townsmen, with one exception. The Irish Guards, that's the only Irish regiment where it's about 60% rural recruits from locations less than 2,000, so that's what makes the Irish Guards very interesting. And then it's the same data, just showing you the percentage of urban population, the Royal Irish Rifles, Dublin Fusiliers, Munsters, 33%, 30%, 13%. So, and then the other ones basically are very rural regiments, Leinster's 3%, Connaught's 3%, you know, there are not many big towns in those areas. And this is just shows the pattern of Irish battalions seeing action. Initially 1914, 1915, it's just the regulars, and then you have the 10th Division coming in at Gallipoli, August 1915, another step up, Ulster Division to France in October, and finally 16th Irish Division arriving between December and February 1916. So it's peaking in 1916, and then after the Somme you start getting units disbanded due to manpower shortages, and that really accelerates February 1918, before the German offensive, a big British reorganisation, and after the German offensive, even more disbanded. So you're down to about 30 Irish battalions in action by the end of the war, from a peak of over 50. Now, what's this? Medal Society. Guys, come on. Do I have to tell you? British War Allied Victory Medal. Okay, I thought you'd answer that. these medals were awarded to anyone who saw active service in the British Army in World War I. These are the amounts awarded by Irish regiments. In total, 121,000 were awarded to Irish regiments out of a total of 4.2 million. That's like 3%. And then the breakdown by regiment, it's pretty in line with who's the large regiments, who's the low ones, like Royal Irish Rifles, 24,000. And down to the Irish Guards, Connaught Rangers, as small as 7,000. So that gives you an idea of how many are theoretically in circulation. The medal rolls, which where all this is recorded, there are, as you may know, they're of interest because they tell you which units a man served with. So, and then this time, do you know what this is? 1914 star, 1914-15 star, okay. Again, this was awarded to anyone who first saw action by the end of 1915. The 1914 star, you had to arrive in France by 22nd of November 1914, and the 1415 star covers all other situations up to the end of 1915. Again, about 18,000 awarded to the Irish Infantry, 1914 star, 18,000 out of 340,000, that's about 5%, the original BEF basically going to France in late 1914. And then the 1415 star is about 57,000 to Irish regiments out of 1.4 million, that's 4%. These medal rolls are of interest because it tells you when a man first saw action. So if you combine the two medal rolls, you're actually able to compile the original members of the battalion if you want to do battalion research. And again, just to give an indication, 1914 star Irish Guards, that's just under 1,600 awarded it, so you'd have the original battalion going over in August about 1,000 strong, and obviously they got about 600 replacements by the end of the year. And 1914-15 star, that would have all the original personnel of the battalions which first saw action 1915, so that includes all of the 36th Ulster, most of the 16th Irish, all of the 10th Irish, so you can actually research those units by using this data. Silver War Badge, no one's interested in these, they're not named, but they're basically given to men who were discharged for being medically unfit, probably due to wounds, before the end of the war. This data is of interest because it tells you a man's date of enlistment, and you can sort of crack the code on regimental serial numbers. If you get into serial numbers, you can actually find out a lot of information. Again, there's about 30,000 given to recipients from Irish regiments. This continues. It starts in late 1916, and they're still giving them out in 1919. Anyway, about 30,000 went to Irish regiments. Again, it's sort of based on the size of regiments. Royal Irish Rifles, the biggest, at just over 6,000. Connaught Rangers, 1,500. Okay, just to show you how you can put this data to use. This is identifying the original members of the Munster Fusiliers in each of their battalions. The 1st Battalion landed at V Beach, Gallipoli, 25th of April 1915, and we can identify 340 of them died in the war, mostly in Gallipoli, out of about 1,000. That's like 34% fatality rate. That's big. I mean, you can double that for wounded, whatever. You can see not many of those guys came through the war, but that's the highest fatality rate there. The 2nd Battalion landed in France in August 1914. It's actually just about 20%, 212 died. That's less than we expected, certainly not like the first. The reason for that is a load of them get captured at this rear guard action at Etreux on 27th of August. About 100 died, but maybe 500 became prisoners. So therefore, those guys are out of the war until the end, and that explains the lower fatality rate. And now we have the service battalion 6, 7, 8, 9, 6 and 7th. They land at Suvla Bay, Gallipoli, August 1915. They have the same type of history, but interestingly, the 6th is about 25% died, and the 7th 20. So the 6th certainly took higher casualties, and it was at Gallipoli. And the 8th and 9th, they arrived December 1915, so those guys are basically seeing action 1916, 1917, 1918. Those two battalions were disbanded in 1916, but the personnel keep fighting with the 1st or the 2nd. And they're like 20% died in the war, so... And the other ones, they're actually the reinforcements sent to the 2nd Munsters late 1914. But again, it's repeating the same pattern, just over 20% of them would have died in the war. This is a platoon roll book from Michael Lee's granduncle, A.T. Lee, who's a platoon commander in the 6th Munsters at Suvla Bay. I hadn't seen one of these before, but you've donated it to the Dunleary Library Museum. And so it was very useful to analyse these 75 individuals and see what happened to them in the war. Basically I think it was about high 20s to 28% died in the war, most at Gallipoli, but a few later on in France, 1918 in particular. And I think it was about about a fifth were maybe discharged before the end of the war due to wounds, that's the grey, and about 44% actually were demobilised after the war from the regiment, so that might be a higher than we expect percentage, but it's a useful analysis using the medal rolls of what happens to a platoon which landed at Gallipoli in 1915. Victoria Cross, yeah. Just to give a slightly different take on, okay, I can mention all the VCs won by the Irish regiments, but this is just an attempt to relate VCs awarded to the intensity of combat a regiment saw in the war. British Army regiments, they're all shapes and sizes, no two are the same because they raise a different number of battalions depending on recruitment, some get disbanded as the war goes on, so no two are the same. This, the number of dead would reflect the intensity of combat a regiment suffered. So when we divide the number of VCs received by the number of casualties, we actually, it is quite interesting. You see the guards in yellow are coming up top, which is, yeah, what you expect. They probably would get favourable consideration for VC recommendations, but the Irish are coming out well. The Leinsters are at the top, and the Irish guards not far behind. Inniskillings down there, and Munsters. So it's just to give a different interpretation on VC data. And Irish World I VC recipients buried in Ireland, and quite scattered around the country, certainly not concentrated in any one area. Just one who died in 1918, James Summers, he won his VC at Gallipoli, the Inniskillings, I don't think died of wounds in 1918, he was buried at Clochjordan, County Tipperary. And the last one would have been John Morney, Jack Morney, Irish Guards. He died in Rosscrea in 1980 and is buried there. But I presume you know many of these names, or I can run through them. William Cosgrave, the Munsters, won it at Gallipoli. He has a very scenic grave in his hometown, Ahaderg, County Cork, near Cove. He died in 1936 in London when they brought the body back to the Cork Harbour, 500 turned out. And Robert Quigg, if you go to Giant's Causeway, Bushmills, he's just inland from the town. He won first day of the Somme VC Ulster Division. Thomas Hughes, Connaught Rangers, is actually from County Monaghan. It's buried in Broomfield, which is outside Carrickmacross. He won his, a Guillemot, 3rd September 1916, VC 16th Division. I've mentioned Jack Moyney, James Duffy, Inniskilling Fusiliers, Palestine, December 1917, stretcher bearer. He's buried in Letterkenny, County Donegal. Martin Doyle of the Munsters, late 1918, France. He died in 1914 in Dublin. He's buried in Grange Gorman, cemetery down the road from McKee Barracks. And finally, Martin Moffat, Sligo, Leinster Regiment, 1918. He's buried in Sligo. Okay, this is an analysis of the Irish Regiment of War Dead. As whether the dead came from the official recruiting district somewhere else in Ireland or non-Irish born. So again, what we see here, the regiments which have the big cities have the highest percentage of men from their recruiting districts, the Munsters, Dublins and Royal Irish Rifles with Belfast. And Irish Guards were very high, they all Ireland recruiting districts. And the more rural districts, that percentage goes down, but they still have generally the same percentage of Irish. They're getting topped up by recruits from Belfast, Cork, Dublin. So Leinsters, they only have a quarter of their personnel from their recruiting district in the Midlands, or the Irish Royal Irish Fusiliers, South Ulster, County Louth, Connaught Rangers. They're all now up to 30%. Yeah. Another factor is some regiments actually actively recruited outside Ireland. They had recruiting officers in England, and certainly the Connaught Rangers, Double Fusiliers, Inniskilling Fusiliers got to direct enlistments from Britain, sometimes tapping into Irish emigrants, but not always. And you can actually see the Inniskilling Fusiliers, a very high percentage of the grey, non-Irish born recruits. Move on to prisoners of war. okay, they survived the war, but for a regiment, prisoners were, like, killed in actions. They're out of the war for good. They're a permanent loss of personnel. The Irish infantry regiments, initially most of their POWs were taken in the retreat from Mons, August 1914, mobile warfare, units cut off. So the big units represented there, the Munsters I've mentioned, Ettore, the Dublin Fusiliers retreating from Le Cateau, the Connacht Rangers, 26th of August, a disastrous action which I think Kevin will touch on later, and Royal Irish Regiment in October, they got surrounded at a little village. And that's, so it's those four regiments are basically the dominant POWs until we come to 1918. And the Ulster Division would have lost a few in July 1916, the Somme. But we have to come to March 1918. This is absolutely catastrophic for the Irish infantry regiments. By now, they've been, except the Irish Guards, they're all concentrated in the 16th or 36th Divisions. These units pretty much get wiped out in the Great German Offensive. And each of them lost in the region of 5,000 POWs, infantry prisoners in that, which massive loss, 10,000 Irish infantry. We have very accurate figures for the officers, and again, it's like 68% of officers from Irish regiments who were taken prisoner. It's from March 1918. Just move a little bit on to executions. This has been well covered in the exonerations campaign about 10 years ago, but executions in Irish regiments were a higher percentage than their share of the army overall. 1915 in particular, 15, and the rest of all 7 or 8%, when at the time the Irish presence, the British army, it's down 5%, 4%, 3% by the end. And another way of looking at it, executions represented 10% of the actual death sentences, only 10% were actually carried out. But if we relate death sentences in Irish regiments by the number of casualties they took, again, the Irish regiments come out with a very high rate of death sentences. I mean, this is the top doing that methodology. You have the Munsters, Leinsters, an English regiment, North Staffs, Royal Irish Rifles, Royal Irish Fusiliers, Royal Scots Fusiliers, Connacht Rangers. So, one, two, three, five, is it? Five of the top seven regiments using that measurement are Irish. Mutinies. The most famous incident is the Connacht Rangers after the war in India. That's 1920. It's a post-war incident. But during the war, I think the Irish regiments generally have a pretty good record on this. There's some. The first case of mutiny overseas was actually three men of the Munster Fusiliers who just landed in France in October 1914. Three of them were sentenced for mutiny, but the sentences were quashed. And we have a few cases at home, units training the seven men of the 8th Enniskillings who were based at Tipperary, but they probably were doing some recruiting tour in Enniskillen, but they were sentenced for mutiny and damage to public property. Interesting, Irish Guards, this is a case where men tried to break into the guardhouse to free some of the comrades under detention. And there's a similar case to the Irish Guards after the war, so they certainly tried to look after each other. But the most serious case of mutiny in Irish regiments was at the end of March 1918, after the Great German Offensive, over 100 men from the 49th Brigade of the 16th Irish Division, they were stragglers or returnees from leave. They'd been collected at the Brigade HQ before being sent back to their battalions. They refused to carry barbed wire up to the front line, and these, add up the figures, one of the things, about 118, they were sentenced, but the sentences were quashed, which was quite remarkable under the circumstances. This data is from Julian Putkowski, who also did pioneering work on the executions, but he thinks it was very lenient treatment for this incident. But we can't help feeling that this incident also affect the reputation of the 16th Irish Division. It was never rebuilt after that. It was, well, like many British divisions, it was reconstituted with personnel from anywhere. And just finally, the one I haven't mentioned yet is a post-war mutiny in the Curragh by a cavalry regiment, 5th Dragoon Guards. Post-war, you get many mutinies due to the slow pace of demobilisation, and this is one of them, but it's 185 men in the Cairo in September 1919. So, and there's other instances like that in non-Irish regiments. So in terms of mutiny, until we come to the Connaught Rangers, the Irish regiments, I think, pretty good record there. I'll just, to finish off, I'll just quickly run through individual battalions, because they did have different aspects, different compositions, and some are quite interesting. We start with the Irish Guards. I've mentioned the unique Irish regiment composed of countrymen, men, majority of rural recruits, and disproportionately from the south of Ireland as well, because about three battalions of the Ulster Division were also majority rural, which probably would have impacted on recruitment of the Irish Guards. But in many southern Irish counties, the Irish Guards are a serious rival to the local regiment for recruiting men from the countryside. Of interest, their second battalion, wartime battalion, it got most of the RIC volunteers, about 400 to 600. So that's one interesting. That must be about 40% of the battalion. Connaught Rangers, they're interesting. At first, it was the only Irish battalion to see action in Mesopotamia, so they have a more varied war than anyone else. They were in France 1914-15, Mesopotamia 1916-1917, go to Palestine, so they certainly got about. And their second battalion was actually disbanded in late December 1914 due to lack of recruits. They just couldn't keep two regular battalions on active service. Unusually, the Connaught Rangers, they had two battalions already seeing heavy action in 1914. For most of the others, it was just one. So it just proved too much more to maintain. A quick rundown through a sample of infantry battalions from the 10th Irish Division. This division was the first to be formed from wartime volunteers in Ireland. Outside Belfast, Irish recruitment it wasn't like Britain, this flood of recruits. So the decision was made to bring this division up to strength with excess British recruits in September 1914. So it ends up, it's probably only about 50% Irish personnel, and that varies greatly by battalion. But the 6th Royal Irish Rifles, they benefited from the recruitment in Belfast. It's the only homogenous Irish battalion in the 10th Division, so interesting for that. Connaught Rangers 5th, again a majority Irish battalion. They had a battalion commander who did recruiting tours around Connaught, and Gallipoli, they actually saw action in the Australian sector, Anzac. They were separated from the rest of the division at Suvla Bay, and they took very heavy casualties there. And uniquely in Serbia, December 1915, the 10th Irish Division, the first British Army unit sent to the Macedonian theatre, the Connaught Rangers suffered very heavily there. I just mentioned the Seven Monsters as being the other extreme. There are hardly any Irish. They actually had to top them up with recruits from Yorkshire, although most of their officers were actually from Munster. But that's one of the battalions which, you know, there just wasn't any significant recruiting in their own district. And 7th Royal Dublin Fusiliers, they're well known because of the company of volunteers, Irish Rugby Football Union, and a great book produced on them, The Powers of Suvla Bay. And it's the only source of Dublin Fusiliers combat photographs I've seen there. It's that book, and unfortunately they're all tiny thumbprint type photos. Just move on to the 16th Division, the 47th Brigade. If ever you want to study the Irish National Volunteers who joined up in World War I, this is where you start. The 6th Connaught Rangers and 7th Leinsters, particularly the Connaughts, they had significant numbers of Belfast National Volunteers. The 8th Munsters, uniquely majority majority County Limerick battalion, usually Cork predominated under the Munsters, but that reflected the recruiting from Irish National Volunteers in Munster, and an individual particularly active in that recruitment was Larry Roach, founding member of the GAA from Brewery, County Limerick. And finally, the 6th Royal Irish Regiment, that's Willie Redmond's battalion, they had an entire company of Derry Nationalists who joined up together and given their own company in that battalion. And they also had a company from Guernsey militiamen who asked to be sent to this regiment because the Royal Irish had been in the Channel Islands pre-World War I, but they actually didn't need recruits. These units were up to strength very quick. It was a very successful initiative. The rest of the 16th Division, just to mention, the 7th Irish Fusiliers, 7th Royal Irish Rifles, these are northern regiments which had difficulties recruiting because all the guys went to the brigade I just mentioned, so they were happy to take a company of Guernsey and Jersey militia to top them up. Dublin Fusiliers, the 8th Battalion, this is probably the Southern Irish volunteer, wartime volunteer unit which took the most casualties, over 500 in 1916-1917. 400 in 1916, which is a horrific total. They suffered severely in the gas attacks April 1916, the same time as the Easter Rising. And their sister battalion, the 9th, Tom Kettle's unit, Emmett Dalton, again, slightly less casualties, but those are the two main Dublin Fusilier wartime volunteer units. 9th Munsters, they didn't last very long, but they're very interesting. A very high percentage of men from County Cork, and that reflected recruitment efforts of Daniel D. Sheehan, MP, who's actually a member of Maurice Healy's All for Ireland League, not Redmondite. This, I guess, is a legacy of the old Parnellite split, but extremely high percentage of Cork men, but that battalion was broken up May 1916 for reinforcements. The Munsters really had recruiting, replacement shortages. But it's a very interesting unit from a recruiting viewpoint. And then I'll just mention the 7th and the Skillings. Again, they have a very nice regimental history written about them. And uniquely, there's a cemetery which they started. It's the first 60 graves are only from this unit, a place called Mazengarden. So that battalion cemetery is quite unique. Just move on to the Ulster Division. This page is, I call them the A-team, the ones from outside Belfast. Excellent units, and I'll just run through them. The 9th Royal Irish Fusiliers, predominantly Armagh, some Cavan Monaghan, and in 1917 they get replacements from the North Irish Force. They took over 200 dead on the first day of the Somme and over 500 casualties. Inniskilling Fusiliers, West Ulster, three battalions. The 9th was the Tyrone Battalion. It's interesting, it's a rural one in terms of its composition, and it's also fascinating because about 10% of its strength are from Dublin and Wicklow. It's the Loyal Dublin Volunteers. It's the only unit in the Ulster Division where you get Southerners. The 10th, the Derrys, and the 11th, Donegal and Fermanagh, again rural, and it's the only unit in the Ulster Division where they had to top up with outsiders. About 40% were from Tyneside. We'll move on to the Royal Irish Rifles. 11th South Antrim, a rural battalion, 12th Central Antrim, and the 13th, the County Down Battalion. Again, highest losses in the first day of the Somme, nearly 600 casualties, again, over 200 killed in action. Now we come to the Belfast battalions. Often in Irish nationalist opinion, there was a perception, one of the grievances was, look at the Ulster Division, they get to choose their own officers, whereas we don't. Well, arguably it backfired. There's a whole brigade from Belfast, and when it landed in France, the new division commander really didn't think they were up to scratch. He had to remove a lot of officers, replace them. This brigade had suffered three executions in February and March 1916 before seeing serious action in July. But yes, I guess eventually, eventually they improved. But I now move on to the 14th, the Young Citizen Volunteers from Belfast. This is an organisation which predated the UVF, the Home Rule Crisis. It charged a membership fee, so it had a middle class composition. It's an interesting unit in terms of, well, money literate men, artists, and a nice set of photographs taken as well. But as a combat unit, it seems to have been a failure. The divisional commanders, Nugent makes many references to this, and maybe pampered in their training. There's one, they were based in Finnair camp with the three battalions of Inniskillings, and after one exercise, the Inniskillings had to march back, but these guys insisted on taking the train back. Anyway, just to move on to, finish with this. 10th Royal Dublin Fusiliers. This unit initially did not serve with the 16th and 10th Divisions. It was sent to the 63rd Royal Navy Division, and it saw action with them the last day of the Somme, 13th of November, over 100 dead. It was a successful attack. Ironically, their first action was in the Easter Rising. They were in Collins, the Royal Barracks, Dublin, and they lost an officer in the Rising whose brother was on the rebel side. It was called the Commercials. It was the two main groups Irish recruiting literature mentions as not having joined up in numbers were shopkeepers' assistants and farmers' sons. So the Royal Dublin Fusiliers was the Commercial Pals Battalion and was meant to address that. And it has a more all-Ireland composition than the other battalions of the Royal Dublin Fusiliers. And just to mention the farmer's sons, there was an 8th Leinster's mentioned in some recruiting literature targeting farmer's sons, but it never got off the ground. Just to mention the 7th Royal Irish Regiment, converted from the South Irish Force late 1917 and wiped out in March 1918, but rebuilt thanks to the Dublin Fusilier recruits mid-1918. And I haven't really been looking at regular battalions, so I'd better mention one here. The 2nd Royal Irish Rifles, one of the battalions landed August 1914 in France, sees action right through the end of the war. It's the Irish battalion which took the most casualties, over nearly 1,500 killed in action in that one battalion, which is the highest for any Irish unit. Okay, with that I'll conclude and hand over to Kevin.
Martin's going to have lots of questions because there's a fascinating statistical analysis.